Good evening. Welcome all of you who are here with us in the Commissioner's Auditorium and those of you who are watching at home. This is our budget workshop tonight, starting at 5 p.m. We're very close to 5 p.m. I'll call our meeting to order and we'll do our roll call by hand. Everybody? Everyone's here. Thank you. We'll have our invocation by Commissioner Williams and our pledge by Commissioner McGlaughorn. Will you please stand?
Let's bow our heads. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your mercy and your grace. We ask you to bless all of us here as we deliberate for your people. All these things I ask in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Join me for the pledge. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'll entertain a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Okay. If you'll all raise your hand if you're in favor of that motion. Any opposition, raise your hand. Okay, I think it passes. And we are here to revisit some of the expectations that we had. And I know our team here has been very busy for over a week, and we thank you for the time and effort that you've put in, and hope I can say thank you at the end. Okay, so the first thing we have are for you to bring up the follow-up items. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman Ward. First thing we want to follow up on were the question regarding locally paid teachers, and we've got a handout here to give you. Take it up there. Let that get around to you. Basically, we did a survey of our surrounding counties as well as our similarly sized counties to find out how many locally paid teachers they pay out of current expense like Pitt County does. And this would be for the current year that we're in, the 15-16 year. So the left-hand column, again, you can see the counties, whether surrounding counties or similarly sized counties. You can see their average daily membership, the number of students within each of the respective school systems, and then that next column, the number of locally paid teachers. So obviously Pitt has 50 locally paid teachers with an average daily membership of 23,349, and then shows our low wealth allocation, and then the supplement that is currently provided. Then you can see the same thing for these systems, and it's kind of a smattering of data. I don't know if there's any clear trends here. Again, depending whether you're looking at surrounding counties or more of our traditional, what we call our peer counties.
Now, I know this was a topic of discussion during the Board of Education's presentation when they were trying to compare surrounding counties' supplement size as compared to Pitt counties. And I think it was Commissioner Garris that asked about the locally paid teachers. So
you can see on the supplement, it goes everything from a flat rate to a percent. Burford County has 46 locally paid teachers, but they only have a flat rate of $1,600 compared to our 50 locally paid teachers, even though we have a much higher average daily membership, and then we have the percent. So it's there's no clear trend here as to how it's handled. And then there's some holes in the data, too, in terms of a couple of counties where we, like I said, not received the data yet.
Correct.
And one of the questions, and you all may have the answer, but I don't think that all 50 of these are teachers. Is that correct?
I think you are correct.
There are some who are administrators.
Assistant principals.
Assistant principals, secretaries, whatever. I don't know that administrative assistants are in there, but I know that it's a real mixture. So when we say teachers, it's not always mm-hmm. teachers. And I think for the size of our county, it's kind of a large number. Anybody have any questions about this? Yes, Ms. Williams.
The one concern that I have about this, and I don't know whether it's in your scope or not, is the district or the area that I represent has a lot of Hispanic residents. And I've discovered that some of the, at least two of them, I think, have a bilingual person in administration to assist them with interpreting conversation and communication between the parents who come in to see about their child and school personnel. And if that is a separate allocation that is paid by local county, I'm for keeping that because communication is important in the child's learning and to have parents not be frustrated over communication. I'd like for us to think about that particular thing because it is worthy for the child in learning to be able to communicate with somebody who speaks Dutch.
And that is certainly worthy. Something that the school system, you know, decides on who the supplements
but
go
I understand
to or whatever.
The local contracts are expiring for some of those. So if that's the case, I'd like to see that a part of that local pay thing because it's need and necessary for our students and families.
Right. And that's still an issue that school board's got to deal with when they make the assignment. So it's a very good idea. It really is, and it needs to be looked at. Any other comments?
Well, I would just say thank you very much for pulling together this information. It looks like, in summary, we do well versus our surrounding counties, but when we look at our peer counties of similar size, it's from one extreme to the other. So I agree with what you said. It doesn't show any clear trend, but thank you for getting that information.
Okay. Sure.
Madam Chair.
I'm sorry. Oh, excuse me, yes.
I would just say I agree with Mr. Garris, but what these numbers show is a shortcoming of the state, not of the counties.
I agree. Mm-hmm. Thank you for saying that.
Yeah.
Yes.
May I compliment on what Glenn just said? Historically, you know, it's the state's responsibility to pay the teachers and funding. And how this, and Beth, you know this better
sure.
than I, but the concept of having extra teachers funded by the county was to try to get some extra things in the schools to embetterment the teachers. But if you go down and look at Durham, mm-hmm. where Durham's got so much wealth that they can get in all
exactly.
the money they want. And those other high rates go with that too. But based on the tax base that we have, it's good that we can give any supplement, but by closing, you can never give your teachers too much money, I don't think.
Right.
And if it's a means whereby we use to bring in teachers and to recruit and to get the better teachers, it might be an issue that we want to evaluate at some time when the growth in the county is more than 3%.
I agree. Thank you. Any other comments?
We did have one other item for follow-up.
Okay.
It's not on the agenda, but just our real intent was to have this follow-up occur on Monday, June the 6th, and that's regarding vehicles. A question was raised concerning the sheriff's office in terms of the report they gave you during their presentation. We did meet with the sheriff's personnel last Friday. Dwayne and I met for a good while to discuss the different reports that were presented to you, trying to sort through those, and had suggested at that meeting Friday that a formal report would be made Monday, June the 6th. I think the sheriff had communicated today that he had instructed his staff, I mean, his business officers here, in case any questions came up. In talking to the chair, I believe she would like to have this handled on the Monday the 6th, unless the board has a desire otherwise.
I think that was our intent to, when we had more time to talk about it and discuss it. Thank you for bringing that up. Okay. Okay, you ready for your
yes, ma'am.
Presentation? Okay.
This is going to be a joint presentation. I'm going to kick it off, but Dwayne's going to get thick in the weeds once I kind of make the introductory comments.
So we have a composite table coming before you.
I don't think Is
the mic on? Test, one, two, three. Okay. Let the table come around to you first. So what we did was we went back and looked at the different comments we'd written down and the tape of the meeting and tried to capture the different budget scenarios that you asked for us to bring back to you, and created basically three scenarios that you directly asked for, and then the first one's really kind of a modified scenario out of my original recommended budget to you. So the first one is labeled scenario number one, manager's revised recommendation. As you recall, I originally had a recommended budget with the 70 cent tax rate, and then with the employee increases of the 2.6 or 3.8. Basically what this one does, drops that suggested tax increase down to 69.5 cents. One thing you see in green going across all four scenarios, those are the items that we felt you as a board collectively asked us to bring back and include back into the budget. That being the first one, DSS at 70,000, those are the four positions that they had asked for that are 75% federally reimbursed. The next one is the mental health diversion. That's the position within the detention center to work with mental health issues of folks coming in who are incarcerated. And then the next two are related to the Pitt County Schools and Pitt Community College in terms of their capital needs, their ongoing needs. The $250,000 would be an additional increase to Pitt County Schools on top of the annually appropriated $750,000 that is given per year. As you recall, they pointed out the fact that they've added, I think, over 1 million square feet of additional classroom space or school space that we have not, in essence, increased this allocation for. Similarly, the same thing with Pitt Community College. As you're aware, in the...
A little bit louder.
In the past...
I don't know whether it's the mic or what.
In the past 10 plus years, they as well have added just as many, well, not in terms of square feet, but they've added a number of buildings that have increased their footprint on the campus. And with that, that's the justification for that $25,000. I'm going to let Dwayne in a moment go in the more the weeds of this. Scenario 2, 3, and 4. Scenario 2 is a 68.6 cent suggested tax rate. That is your revenue neutral, which I believe was 67.24, plus the Pitt Community College debt of 1.36 cents. That comes out to 68.6. That was the scenario that asked for a 5% across the board employee increase or allocation. Next one, scenario three, again, is a 68.6 tax rate. That's a 3% across the board rather than a 5%. And then scenario number four, again, you get back to that 68.6 cent tax rate with the 2.6 or 3.8 percent increase. I'm going to ask Dwayne, if he would, to come forward, and he's going to talk about effect on fund balance and maybe other factors that were involved in this.
We felt like it would be advantageous to look and isolate each one of these scenarios independently, just for presentation and clarity purposes. Each of the scenarios will have this basic format where we highlight the tax rate. We follow that by the amount of the total general fund budget, the employee increase plan, whether it's a pay for performance and market adjustment or a across the board. We also isolate the fund balance appropriation that would be required under each scenario. Some of the scenarios have a required reduction and or additional fund balance appropriation. And as we walk through that, you will see that you will have the opportunity to either take further reductions in the budget, increase your appropriated fund balance, or have some combination of the two. That's followed by the budget expansion items, and we'll talk about that as we get to those scenarios where those are a factor. The manager already mentioned the additional expenditure items. We have some notes for each scenario, and then the net effect on the 6/30/17 fund balance. And this is a forecast of what each scenario's impact would be
at the end of next fiscal year, and that's a net movement. So with the first scenario, as a result of the budget workshop's discussion, the manager has come with a revised tax rate of 69.5 cents. This changes the total general fund budget to $167,549,866. That's approximately, that's right at $402,000, not approximate, but exactly $402,000 difference from the original proposed budget. And that is the result of the expenditure additions in the green. Those four items, DSS, mental health diversion, and the two additional capital items total $402,000, okay? There would be no required reduction in or fund additional fund balance appropriation in this scenario, except for the fact that under the manager's scenario, reducing the tax rate by a half of a penny increases your fund balance by $600,000. So one penny generates approximately $1.2 million. So in the manager's revised scenario, you would be increasing your fund balance plug or appropriation by $600,000, and then also the $402,000 of the expenditure additions is also included in the fund balance appropriation. We do say under this scenario that the rate is reduced. It does maintain the 2.6 and 3.8% adjustments for employee increases. We do fund some all of our one-time, and our goals throughout each of these scenarios is to fund. We really want to try to use fund balance for one-time items versus recurring items. That is possible in some scenarios, and you'll see in others it's not. And then the estimated net effect on our 6/30/17 fund balance under the manager's revised recommended budget would be a negative 0.04%, relatively keeping the fund balance flat by the end of the next fiscal year. Yes.
I can add a comment to that. So the fund balance remains relatively flat, but my idea, my suggestion or recommendation to the board would be to consider using that excess fund balance for one-time projects, i.e. animal shelter expansion addition, $1.8 million is one opportunity. The radio and paging project, even though we have identified the revenue stream to make the debt payments on that $5.5 million project, you could appropriate $2 million of fund balance, pay $2 million of it upfront in cash, finance the remaining portion of it, and then create some excess capacity in the following year or year after in terms of budget flexibility. So did want to add that I'm not just ignoring the fact that there is excess fund balance above 20%, but there is a suggested plan as how to utilize that, as Dwayne mentioned, using it for one time rather than reoccurring. But
under scenario two, you'll see that this does include the revenue neutral rate plus the PCC GO bond financing for a total rate of 68.6 cents. The total general fund budget does show a reduction because of the fact that you would be reducing your tax rate. We do have a fund balance appropriation in this scenario of $3,083,000. And what this scenario does is it increases the fund balance appropriation by the amount of the expenditure additions, as well as we had in the original, the backup PSAP at $681,000. In order to accomplish a balanced budget in this scenario, you would need to reduce your original budget by $2.5 million or appropriate an additional $2.5 million of fund balance or some combination of the two. We did want to just highlight the largest expansion items in the proposed budget. And those two items are the public schools increase of 1.637 and the new positions. When we start to look at opportunities to cut the expansion, I realize it's not a budget cut, it's an expansion. It would be an expansion cut or reduction. But in order to bring the budget into balance, you would have to reduce those expansion items. But even with those two large expansion items, you'll see that those only total $2.3 million. So were you to cut both of those expansion items, you could then appropriate an additional $200,000 of fund balance, for example, to balance the budget. Or you could just keep the expansion items and appropriate it all in fund balance. But again, we're very cautious. We would warn you against utilizing your fund balance for recurring items and making that an ongoing practice. We under the estimated net effect on 6/30/17 fund balance, we really can't project that until and or unless the board would direct whether the balancing of this scenario would be accomplished by a expenditure reduction or an appropriation of fund balance or a combination of the two. So depending on the direction that was given under this scenario, we would not be able to forecast the impact on fund balance until and unless that was decided. Yes, definitely. Thank you. You'll see one additional item in the green. The last item in the green under scenario two says additional employee increase. That's what that abbreviation stands for. And that is the difference between what is currently in the budget for employee increases and what would be required to bring everyone to 5% across the board. $874,525. Okay. Yes, and that is included in your required reduction and or additional fund balance appropriation. That's in that 2.5 figure. The next scenario, scenario three, is exactly the same scenario as scenario two. The only difference in scenario three is it accommodates an employee increase requested at 3.8% across the board. That was also requested at our last budget workshop meeting. And then the final scenario, again, keeps a tax rate at 68.6 cents. And it keeps your employee increases at the 2.6 or 3.8. The difference in this scenario is that instead of accomplishing the reduction in the tax rate by any reduction in expenditures or expansion requests, this scenario assumes that the balancing act for this budget would be accommodated by increasing the fund balance appropriation by the amount to balance. And so it takes your fund balance appropriation from 2.6 basically to 4.7. I will note that the estimated net effect on 6/30/17 fund balance is less than 1%. It's 0.87% negative. And so instead of where we are forecasting right now based on year-to-date activity for our fiscal year 6/30/16 fund balance to be at 23.08%, I would forecast that under this scenario we would be at 22.21% by the end of the next fiscal year.
So those are the, other than the first one I admit you did not ask for, but thought we would throw it out there as a suggestion. Scenarios 2, 3, and 4 is what we interpreted that you as a board had asked us to analyze and research and bring back to you. As Dwayne had said, number 2 and number 3 depending upon what direction you'd want to go, if you're considering one of those two, the required reductions needed or the increase in fund balance. Again, I would just echo again what I'd said and Dwayne said, just need to be very careful about using fund balance for reoccurring expenditures. As the board is aware, we will be going before the bond rating agencies in New York in the next month to present to them the, what's the total package that we're borrowing this time?
$20 million new money and approximately $10 million refinance.
$30 million package. I mean, it wouldn't affect this borrowing because this is still in the planning stages. But in the future, for future borrowings, if we do increase our fund balance appropriation, they will ask questions. And hopefully we'll have a solid position to tell them why we're doing it, how we're doing it, what effect it's not having or is having, and that we're making strategic decisions that are sound, per se. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. I think maybe the best way to do this is like we did previously. Glenn, we'll start with you, and if you have any questions or you want to speak to any one of these scenarios in any way, and we'll just go down and
let everybody
have that opportunity.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I've got a couple. Why aren't these school and manager positions under scenarios 1 and 4?
We were trying to keep scenario number 1 as pure as we could to the originally adopted budget, other than adding those 4 things in green.
So they wouldn't be in there at all?
Well, that under this scenario, they wouldn't. I will say under scenario 4, and again, this was an attempt to try to gather the feedback that we got from the board collectively. In scenario 4, for example, that under that one, we didn't feel like there was a request to show corresponding cuts that would need to be made. That one was just made up in fund balance appropriation.
So those positions and the school increases, if we went with scenario 4, would not exist? Or they would, they're just unaffected by the scenario?
They're in there.
They're already in there.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just didn't understand why they weren't listed under there.
Each of the 4 scenarios takes the base budget and then adjusts it to what is being shown on the page here. So whatever you heard on the first day of the budget workshops in my budget message is still there unless it's been taken out.
I just got a little confused on that. In the difference in scenarios 2 and 3, why is 5% 874 and 3.8 is only 310,000 in employee increases?
Well, it has to do with the difference between what is in the budget now at the 1.4% across the board, because under the original budget, 1.4 is applied to every single person. Under the pay for performance, we're saying 2.6 and 3.8, but remember that's divided into 2 different adjustments. The 1.4 is across the board. The additional 1.2 or 2.4 is allocated per individual employee and based on their where they fall in our classification system.
I understand, but in scenario 3, is the 3.8 a flat 3.8?
Yes.
Yes.
And so that looks like all numbers are equal there. It just 1.2%. More wouldn't seem like another $500,000. You see what I'm saying? Under scenario 2, a flat 5%, the additional employee increase would be 874, and under the 3.8, under scenario 3, it would be only 310. So the difference of 1.2 is 564,000. And I leave the door open that I am completely looking at this wrong, but.
I have to look at that, but I don't know. I don't have the backup with me.
I understand.
Here to show how we arrived at that.
Yeah, that flat 1.2 just seems like a drastic increase on that.
Can I ask one question relative to that that'll maybe help me understand? When you do 5% for every person, the ones who get higher salaries, that does that affect that total number in comparing it to the 3.8 times the higher salaries?
Well, it definitely does, because when you apply these percentages, again, it's not a straight line per se, because it's going to depend on what someone's base salary is.
What they're actually making.
Right, so that's going to vary by employee, but again, I want to look at the
But that shouldn't be different if it's a flat rate.
That's
3.2%, 1.2% difference shouldn't be $560,000. The other question I have is, since we right-sized, I think it was 2012, do we have less positions or more positions in the county than we did at that time?
Well, probably the last two budget cycles, maybe three budget cycles, we had gradually added back. I think you remember probably 2 years ago, we added the 30 positions within DSS. We've probably, on average, besides those, added 5 to 10 a year.
Probably 5 to 10.
So we're at more than we had, because I think we cut 12 positions total that were vacant. No one got fired. But was it 8 or 12 that we cut?
During the, many more than that. Just within DSS, we cut those 30-plus positions. Okay. We'd have to go back and research that, but I would think at least 50 or 60.
Okay.
Florida, do you have any knowledge? Not here, off the top of your head. Okay.
Okay, thank you. And I think I was thinking of the dollar amount in millions that we cut versus the actual number of employees. And that's all the questions. I'd just like a number on that, the difference in the 3.8 and the 5. And you know what I'd like to do, and what I've been mentioning through the process, is being able to do something to where we can get these employees back to about where the cost of living should be for the ones that we missed and that percentage that we were behind, versus taking on a lot of new positions that we then have to do the same thing for, and we just track farther behind, because it's every new person is a new amount of money and a new. And that, and we're not just talking salary, benefits, and everything that come along with it. And that's my next and last question. On the DSS positions, I know that they're paid for by the federal government, in portion by the federal government. But is it only their salary, or is it also their benefits package, retirement, and everything else?
The whole package.
The whole thing is three quarters.
Salary.
Okay, good. All right, that's all the questions I have. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Okay.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I really don't have any questions. I have a couple of comments and observations. My first comment is thank you very much for pulling this together. I felt like at the end of our last budget workshop that you guys had a challenge because of the various options that we were all looking at, and I think you have built a very understandable scenario here, including each of our thoughts. And I will go on and state up front the position that I'm going to support. The scenario that I'm going to support is going to be scenario 4 for these reasons. Number 1, it assumes a revenue neutral tax rate. And number 2, it includes those positions that we emphasized during our workshop, the DSS positions and the mental health position. And it also includes the $250,000 additional capital to K-12 and the additional $25,000 to PCC. And I'm very supportive, as our manager stated earlier, the square footage of buildings that both of those entities have significantly increased, and we have not increased their ongoing capital allocation. So I'm supportive of both of that. It also includes the other items that our manager presented to us during our budget workshop last week, including the pay, the increased pay for the schools, and I'm supportive of all of that. So I am supportive of scenario 4. The other thing that scenario 4 does is it still leaves us with a fund balance of 22%, which is 2% in excess of our goal of 20%. Now, I realize that there is some concern about the repeating expenditures in this budget, like the $1.6 million allocated to the schools, but I am confident that our base is going to grow next year, and we can figure out a way to manage that. If worse comes to worse, and we do have to pursue a tax increase to fund that, then I don't see any need of doing it a year in advance. We would wait and do it next year when the need was absolutely there. So I'm supportive of scenario four, Madam Chairman, and yes. I'll let you go around. And okay. When you get through with everybody giving their input, I'm ready to make a motion.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Garris. Mr. Farley?
I'd like to hear from the rest of our esteemed okay. commissioners.
Mr. McLaughlin?
I want to thank Scott and Dwayne for this fine presentation here. The, you know, I think it's very important that we understand that we don't want any tax increase for our most vulnerable citizens here in Pitt County, especially those that that are poor and don't have money to even sustain their way of living now. And these various scenarios that you presented show that, and I appreciate that. I do want to ask the question in reference to scenario number three. Will this also raise the Sheriff's Department deputy's salaries as was recommended with the 3.8%?
The 3.8% across the board for all county employees would also include law enforcement as well. So yes, so the 1.2% that was proposed as part of my original budget would be within the 3.8. They're not getting an additional 1.2%, but so this is a greater percentage under scenario number three than what I had presented back at the workshop.
And I think it's certainly appropriate that we must be mindful that we got to look out for our employees as they continue to do a fine job for the county. And but also, in this scenario number three, you stated that dependent upon the board decision to reduce expenditure, utilize fund balance, or some combination of the two. I'm sure that somewhere down the line, maybe you haven't presented that yet, that you have some idea as to what we could do to make this more of a reality in terms of some cuts. You know, when you do something to help the employees and to help our citizens of the county, somebody got to bite the bullet. You know, someone has to take some cuts. I understand that. And, you know, and I think that the department heads should realize that, too. I'm certainly appreciative of both scenarios. I'm looking at the number three and certainly scenario number four in terms of maintaining our current way of doing business and still not hurt, you know, hurt the county and not to, you know, certainly not to hurt our citizens and our employees. But
if I can respond to Commissioner McLaughlin, in terms of the required reductions, we have not come up with any type of specific list as to where we think this should occur, other than we did point out in blue the two big ticket items that are expansion items that are above and beyond what we do today. Again, that $1.6 million for Pitt County Schools, $755,000 in the new position requests that are in the budget. And as Dwayne was saying, it's either going to take cuts within those two areas or additional fund balance appropriation, or I would hate to think or recommend that we would direct cuts within the general fund within all the departments of county government, because a lot of departments have kind of just came back from the effects of the recession and are starting to get things put back into place. We'd almost be back into a recession mode where we're telling them, okay, 5% across the board, everybody cut. Some departments, that means people, because they, when you come up with percentage scenarios like that, when 90% plus or minus of your allocation is in personnel costs, they have no choice but to cut a position. And our past practice has been those vacant positions. Obviously, we have not gone into positions that are held by people actually in those positions.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Owens?
I've advocated since we went from about 12% fund balance up to what, 23 or wherever we are, that it's not this board's responsibility to create a savings account on taxpayers' money. So I'm all in favor of using fund balance to accomplish what we want here. My only concern is that in scenario four, what will the schools be getting extra, Scott?
They would be getting $1,637,053, which my
which you had in your original proposal.
Right, which we had, yes. had suggested that they consider bringing the beginning teacher supplements from the 2% to 5%, and then the balance of that money, million plus or minus, then would be current expense for their fixed costs.
But all would right. that not be plus 250 that we are adding
yes,
in the
ma'am.
Green to?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. So exactly.
School, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
And they would also get the 430 beginning teacher supplement.
Correct.
2.5%
Right. That's part of the $1.6 million right. in blue.
Okay.
Now to fund the new construction at Pitt Community, well, what's the debt service going to be per year out there?
The first year's debt service is $1.6 million, and that's how we calculated the between the principal and interest, the 1.36 cents of equivalent tax increase needed to retire the debt.
Isn't there a debt service that they're proposing also to the high school out there?
Yes, but that would be paid out of the Article 46 sales tax, which is not general fund dollars. It's sales tax dollars that people pay when they pay appropriate sales tax in Pitt County. Okay. No, there's no cost to, no direct cost. I think we'll probably see some operational costs like utilities, insurance, the normal costs that we have.
There is additional cost, but to that, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, down under the white part, our tax rate is what, right at this time?
68 cents.
All right, and you recommended here on scenario four that we increase it 0.6%?
Correct, and again, you're going from the true revenue neutral of 67.24, you're adding 1.36 for the debt retirement for the PIT bonds, brings you then to a total of the 68.6, so that's really the new base rate with the revenue neutral plus what the debt service, the voter mandated debt service on $19.9 million for Pitt Community College facilities.
All right, when the citizens voted upon the bond and it passed, at that time we were speculating that it would take how much tax increase?
1.85 cents.
So we're down to 0.60 for that. Is that correct under this
down budget? Down to 1.36 cents.
Right.
All right. Now down in the white part on scenario four, where you say recommended employees increase, that's their additional expenditures, which we've talked about. Funds $500,000 for one-time expenditure, and you itemized as what they were. So you're saying that you have already evaluated how much money it's going to take for vehicle replacement, that being $225,000?
Well, we have there's two things going on with vehicle replacement. We have the normal loan that is coming back into play in the new year of $650,000. And as you recall, during the budget workshops, we increased that from
615
to 650. Mm-hmm. And then we have $225,000 we wanted to propose to, the 650 would be a loan.
So you're talking about $900,000 loss of vehicles?
875 to be exact.
Yes, sir.
And there's no, we do have a need to replace vehicles. We have not identified where in what departments. That'll come back to you in a subsequent presentation and recommendation.
But that's a variety of departments.
Yes,
that's
ma'am.
A question for me. But
yes.
A variety of departments,
as
not just
we
one.
Have traditionally done, yes.
Okay.
Unless you direct us otherwise.
Now, I did, and I think Glenn brought this along too about the extra position for mental health in the jail. Is that included within the connotations of what we've got here?
Yes, sir, in all four scenarios.
Sir?
In all four scenarios, yes.
Okay.
That's the MH diversion in green.
I got you. Okay. Thank you. Do you want us to tell you which one we are?
No, you don't have to do that yet. We're going to get a motion when we finish. Then we'll see if anybody else wants to make one.
The last time there seemed to be a lot of discussion about overtime pay. which one of these scenario has it? It was one talking about the sheriff, and then one in one incident we talked about everybody else. Is this for everyone, this overtime pay?
Any department that had requested overtime pay, that was considered as part of the base budget, and recommendations were made in that based. And those recommendations, i.e. take the sheriff's department, we look at where they landed on their feet the following fiscal year ending 2015, mm-hmm. and then looking at what they'd spent so far in the current year we're in for 15-16, looking at their request and then balancing it out. In areas they may have asked for more overtime than what was recommended, but that's just the nature of the beast of the process.
What I would, the department that I was really thinking about is the one that seemed to be out working more this year than ordinary in an election year, because we have all of those elections. And I'm hearing discussions about other counties. Now, the personnel in the Board of Elections office, their overtime pay is not going to be in, what you call that, where you don't get paid in dollars, you get paid in time off.
Comp time or
comp time. Are they into that, or are they going to be like the sheriff? Because I think it's the sheriff department that getting dollars and cent, correct?
Well, let's go to the Board of Elections first. The Board of Elections, in an election year, they hire a lot of part-time poll workers to work the polls. Mm-hmm. Now, the actual election staff, I'm sure that those who are exempt, if you're exempt, you're not getting the comp time nor overtime. I'm sure they're working more hours, but I'm sure they flex their time as they're able as well. Those employees who are non-exempt may be getting overtime. I'm not familiar with if it
so
is.
We have both.
It's not an issue. Let's put it that way.
Budgetary. So we have both exempt and non-exempt personnel over in the Board of Elections.
Board of Elections staff. Yes. If they're non-exempt, then I'm almost sure they're going to be getting comp time. They're going to be comping their time. Those full-time staff that are at the Board of Elections.
The board's policy, the county policy is, we try not to pay overtime, but to give them comp time, let them flex the hours out, unless it's a situation such as public safety where they just have to. You know, if it's a murder investigation, as the sheriff has pointed out, in past circumstances, he's got to work them 16 hours to solve a case. He can't just say, well, your 8 hours are in, go home, and we'll work on that, you know, the day after tomorrow. Yeah, he will. So he does have a line item for overtime that he manages and tries to stay within.
In a natural disaster or something where people would have to stay 24 hours or whatever.
Correct. Yeah.
Plus, but
a lot of time
basically it's all comp time.
That is our goal.
I was looking at the Board of Elections personnel.
Right.
They have to be there because there are a lot of scenarios that come up that they have to interpret.
Right.
After hours.
Right.
And that's what my concern is.
Yeah.
Are they given any dollars in gratuity for their overtime? That was, or did this is a forced comp time situation?
We try to do comp time as a matter of practice, when and where we can. It's just a budget control. I mean, because if a department does not budget for overtime, then there's really no place to pay it out of, especially if they're fully staffed and have no vacancies. There are circumstances where a department may make a request if they have vacancies to use the lap salary to bring temps in, or in a rare occasion, say within DSS.
That's what I was going to ask about.
With NCFAST, we did pay some overtime because we were under a state mandate, federal mandate, to get those caseloads down. And we, in that case, we did what we had to do and complied and felt like if employees were being asked to work, come in on Saturdays, mm-hmm. and work a 6-day week, we wanted to give them some incentive to be there and to be productive.
Thanks for answering that, because I was going to bring up the DSS next, yeah. Because it is a mandate coming down with Medicare, Medicaid, and stuff.
And that was kind of one time, it was an ongoing one time, but it was a certain period of time that began and ended. It's not like it's ongoing throughout the entire 12 months or year after year.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Williams. Can we back up one step, Mr. Colson? Mr. Owens, do you want to ask your other question you had?
Now, this, I've referenced four, that doesn't mean that's what I'm for, but using that as a reference. Reference four, you got employees increase 2.6 or 3.8. That would be based on paid for performance, is that correct?
It's based upon two factors. One, on July 1st, the way that this is set out, based upon the original budget is presented, everybody would receive the market adjustment of 1.4% come July 1. And then based upon when their anniversary date is in the 12 months through the year, they would be able to earn either the 1.2 or 2.4% merit increase based upon performance.
Plus the 1.4?
Right. So you'd either get a cumulative total of 2.6 or 3.8 by the time you earned it. Now, some people are going to say, well, my anniversary date is not till the middle of the year, so I'm not really getting 2.6 or 3.8. I guess my response back to that would be, your anniversary date to me defines the point. You are getting that amount of money on an annual basis being the point in time that you were hired on that date of the year, not necessarily July 1.
So going for if whatever the board passes as an increased employees, it will commence based on their date of employment?
For the 1.2 and 2.4%, correct. Their anniversary date in the system.
All right, anniversary date.
But everybody will get the 1.4 immediately.
Yes, ma'am.
And the cost of living concept is totally out with this scenario.
Well, that 1.4 is the market adjustment is the cost of living.
Okay. And that's an annual thing. We can do that in budgets hereafter, whatever, increase it or decrease it or whatever the board
yes.
so desires.
Correct. There's been some years, like during the recession, we had three straight years where there was no cost of living, nor was there any merit money just because we were trying to hang on to our coattails and make it through the recession.
And not cut any people.
Talk about revenue neutral. To me, that's always been a play on words, because if you've got an increase in value, like we had a 3% growth, that's still taxing the people that's paying the taxes, regardless of what the rate is.
Correct.
But that, to me, has always been somewhat of a synonymous idea. But I think that... from what I'm reading here, and as Jimmy alluded to, if we wanted whatever scenario we vote on, if we want to continue that next year, you're going to have 4.763 million from somewhere by growth or from fund balance to fund the budget. Is that correct?
If everything held constant
and 100% was spent, that's the other thing.
Very good question, very good point. Of that 4.4 million 763, remember, 2 million is our normal fund balance plug.
I understand that.
It falls back. So really, 2 million 763 is what we would more than likely spend.
The 3% growth we've had this year brought approximately how much? See the point I'm getting to?
Yeah. I think we said the base is growing annually at about 1.5%.
It has.
No, that the revile was a 3%.
Yeah, 3.31%.
I got you. I've answered my question. Thank you.
Mr. Coles? Go on.
I was just going to say that growth generated $2.6 million.
So it's just about what we've got.
Over 3 years or 4 years.
Mr. Colson.
The credit agencies, since that's been brought up a number of times, do they look at the dollar amount or do they look at the percentage of our budget when they calculate favorable rates?
They really look at both. What I think they look more at is the percentage, and particularly as it relates to, one, what you've as a board have said is your policy. They definitely look at your adherence to your own policy. They also look at you compared to other counties and municipalities that have a similar rating.
Whether or not they use one or the other, the fact that the fund balance keeps going up, they would look at that, I guess, as a third alternative and be favorable.
Trends, yes, sir. They definitely
and more. The last time we met is I had brought up how much, or I asked you the question, how many dollars were actually rolled back into this year's fund balance from unspent money last year. And the year before, and the year before, and virtually every year, and I dare say even during the worst of the worst, the recession years, did you ever not roll back some money? Was there ever a case where on June 30th you had to get fund balance to be able to balance the year?
Not to my knowledge. We've always
had. So the point being, we can either leverage our monies, or in my opinion, we can build our fund balance in part, not in total, but in part, on the backs of our employees by giving them less of a raise, remembering full well that for many years they got very little or nothing. And when we talk about 5%, it's really not that much money. If you wanted to look at doubling their salary, it'd take 14.4 years to double their salary if you gave them 5% every single year. When has that ever happened? And when we talk about cost of living, remember, that's not an increase. That's just an offset, in part, to where our federal government spends money that it doesn't have, and that you have inflation. And so that's only an attempt to try to equal it out. So it's not really an increase. So when we talk about revenue neutral, I agree with what Mark was saying, is that it is kind of a misnomer. But of all these scenarios, options 2 and 3, I'm confused. Maybe everybody else understands it. Apparently they do. But on the blue, why does it show up school increases and managers recommend positions under 2 and 3? But I thought I heard you say under option 4, if those things are already built into it.
That's what it
is. If that's built into it already in option 4, how is it different in option 2 and 3?
We felt
or
like
did
we
I
heard,
miss here?
We felt like we heard from you when the individuals were throwing out their scenario or their budget proposal to us. They wanted to see cuts, is what we heard when we heard option 2 and 3 mentioned. When Commissioner Garris mentioned option 4, he didn't necessarily say go make suggest cuts, but we did hear that in 2 and 3 when it was mentioned.
So is the blue meaning it's cut?
No, it's, again, as Duane was saying, in options 2 and 3 in the pink or the reddish color, we need to come up with 2.5 million, almost 2.6 in scenario 2, and in scenario 3, almost $2 million of cuts or additional fund balance appropriation or a combination of those two to balance that out in order to keep that particular tax rate employee increase percentage.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, so scenario number one, the tax rate 69.5, and you reduced it down to the 68.6 for the other three scenarios, that being the 67.24 revenue neutral plus the 1.36%, I believe you said, if I remember correctly,
right,
to come up with that number. And if you looked at option number two and it just was 69 cents, 0.4, that'd be another $500,000, right? 0.4 times $1.2 million, you said?
Yes, sir.
And if you look at the leveraging of the monies that you're going to be rolling back in at the end of the year anyway, and you add the two of them together, that $2.5 million disappears. Those two things take care of it. And the only thing that we can say is we are not going to increase our fund balance on monies we know in all likelihood we aren't going to spend. And the other commissioners may not agree with the 69 cents as opposed to the 68.6, but your original recommendation was 70 cents.
Correct.
So if it was 70 cents, we wouldn't even have an issue. We probably wouldn't even be sitting here talking about it, except that we as a board in general have, I guess, given the indication that we don't like the idea of going beyond revenue neutral and the amount for funding of the building. I still think that we ought to leverage the money. I don't like the fact that for so many years we gave so little. I'm not saying that the county didn't do the best they could under the circumstances, but it is a little bit better. In all likelihood, next year is going to be even better. And while it's not a reval, there should be additional revenues, buildings, and this, that, and the other, and there will be an additional tax increase, something to what Jimmy is saying. But if we go with option or with scenario four here, I'm just troubled with that. The 5% under option two, would that be an immediate increase for everybody?
Yes, sir.
Would sheriff deputies under options two and three still be able to get additional monies for earning certifications?
Yes, sir. That would be built into.
So really, as we have an opportunity here to really do something meaningful to help the sheriff's department and still give a fairly significant amount of an increase to employees. And we can pay for it by just leveraging monies, and I'm going to use that term again, leveraging monies that we know is going to be in all likelihood rolled right back into the fund balance next year, which is likely to be growing anyway, just from interest being earned on it and various and sundry other things that are likely hit it. I agree with what Mark said. Do we want to have a savings account? Is that the purpose of the fund balance? The state mandates 8.5 or whatever it is, 12%, I think, 8.5, isn't it?
8%.
Because you gotta have money to be able to operate. Well, we've got three times that. And if we use this money now, a lot of it's gonna be replaced anyway by the things I've just painted, the picture I just painted.
Excuse me.
Well, I guess you can see that I'm really favoring option two.
Two.
I have no further questions or comments at this particular point.
I want to ask the question about this bookmobile chiller.
Okay.
Explain that to me.
Sure. The bookmobile is a project that's been in the budget for probably 2 years now, being requested by Shepherd Memorial Library. They have an existing bookmobile that's probably 20-plus years old or older that has pretty much gone to its useful span of life. And the $100,000 would allow them to replace that. The bookmobile is used basically in primary rural Pitt County. The chiller is $175,000 is for a chiller here on, will actually be on the Human Services campus at next to the, between the Health Department and the Human Services building. The plan is to replace the chiller there, and the chiller that is there would be brought here as a backup to the chiller we currently have that is desperately needs to be replaced. We have a newer chiller here, plus a very old one, so we would have a newer chiller with a little older one. It's an efficient way of accomplishing our goals without having to buy $275,000 chillers.
And I think the point of clarity is those are two separate items.
Mm-hmm.
They're two separate items. One is a bookmobile and one is a chiller.
Chairman Ward, we can also bring some clarity to the original question on why the dollar difference between the 5% and the 3.8.
Yeah, that was what I was going to ask you. Now, you're talking about the two items in blue. Is that correct?
No, this in green. Okay. I think Commissioner Webb had asked why there was a $500,000 difference between a 5% versus
between
the 3.8.
Between that, which is in the red or the pink.
Yeah. The last item in the green under
okay, the additional employee increase.
Yes, exactly.
And I apologize for the lapse of at the time, but to go from.
Okay, I kind of want everybody to know where we are looking, because
yes, ma'am.
I was a little confused when he was talking about it, and then I forgot that I had put a star by that to indicate that I had found it. So
yes, ma'am.
The question was about the, on the bottom line of the green, where the additional employee increases, mm-hmm. right? And
yes,
why
ma'am.
The difference is as big as it is when you're talking about 5% and 3.8, right?
Correct.
Okay.
Right.
The quick answer is that when you go from the increase from 3.8% to 5% is actually a 31.5% increase going from three. It's not a 1.2% increase going from 3.8% to the 5% is actually a 31.5% increase. So when we look at our general fund salaries, our total general fund salaries are $46.9 million. 5% of that is $2.3 $1 million. 3.8% of that is almost $1.8 million. We currently have $1.475 million in our budget for increases, and so the differences between those two represents the delta between the 5% and the 3.8%.
Did you follow that?
I'm processing. It still seems like the number should be relatively close. I mean, 5% of 46 million and 3.8% of 46 million should only be about 1.2% apart. And so, but it somehow equals 31%. And I do acknowledge that we're a government, so it may not make sense at all.
It's got to do with the fact that you're talking about percentages. Mm-hmm. And so, again, 5% of 46.9 million is 2.3, almost 2.4 million.
Okay.
And 3.8% of that same 46.9 million is almost $1.8 million.
Okay. Mr. Garris, you asked. Oh, wait a minute. Mr. Owens had one other question.
Thank you. Getting back to where Tom was, scenario two versus scenario four, in the pink or red, fund balance appropriate in white, 3 million up above, and under that, parentheses, 2,554,000. What does that 2,554,000 entail?
That is the amount that would be required to either be cut to balance the budget
from
the expansion.
From the recommended budget.
Or increase fund balance by that 2.5, or some combination of the two.
Are you saying the use of fund balance?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Are you saying then, in essence, that use of the fund balance might be 5 million, 554,000?
Yes.
Exactly. We're saying under those two scenarios, we're out of balance, 2.5 million and $1.9 million. Right. And either it's going to take cuts from what was proposed from day one, or some cuts and some additional fund balance increase, appropriation increase.
You said at the outset, Scott, Madam Chair, if I may, that things coming down the pike, so to speak, the radio, four or five million.
Yes.
You had one other item. What was that?
We talked about the animal shelter expansion.
Yes, so you're talking about 2, 6, or 7 million there? But that will be in the next year's budget, not the one we're working on now. Is that correct?
Right, and that's, I mean, if you go with option two, and I know there's another item on the agenda about animal control, but option two is about $210,000 annually in debt service for the $1.8 million expansion.
Now, I'm saying this so I can respond to Tom. I, one momentarily while ago, was set on four. Then when Tom got into me about that, Tom, but if you're going to have the fund balance subject to $5.5 million versus $4,706,000, and then we got these two other items that's coming down the pike at somewhere, the radio and the other one. I think it's best to preserve that for those two items, and so I'm for four.
Okay. I think that it's really important, since I didn't get to speak when we were talking about the budgets, to consider that was why I wanted to, you all to make it very clear that the amount, just like you did, Mr. Owens, when you look at those other two scenarios particularly, that we are really getting into the fund balance, and we've got two major things coming up that we've got to find some money for to get them at least off the ground and started, so that our payments back will not have to be that much when we, you know, start having to pay for them. So I think clarifying the numbers that are in the pink and the green and the blue are very important. Now, Mr. Garris.
Yes, I'd like to clear up one thing back to fund balance.
Yes, sir.
I think it was stated that we've never used fund balance for ongoing operating expenses, and I don't believe that is true, because back 8 or 10 years ago, we had a fund balance of 19%, and we worked that down to 13% using that money for annual operating expenses so that we would not have to increase property taxes. Is that correct?
That's correct. We had a
And that negatively impacted our bond ratings.
It did.
Now, when we built the fund balance back up, we got improved bond ratings. So that fund balance at that 19-20%, even though it is taxpayers' money in a savings account, it's very important as far as our bond raters are concerned, because those bond raters, that determines the amount of interest we have to pay for these loans, and a fraction of a percent can equal thousands and thousands of dollars. So we have used fund balance in the past, but I just wanted to clarify that.
Yes, sir.
The other thing, I would like to move, Madam Chairman.
Yes, sir.
That we present scenario four to the public next week at our public hearing. As I stated earlier, I am supportive of scenario four for the reasons I stated earlier, so I'm not going to repeat those, but I left out one. And I know that there's some disagreement on this particular principle amongst some of our board members, and that's perfectly okay. I have no problem with anybody disagreeing with my principle. But scenario four incorporates the principle of pay for performance. And I am very supportive of that. And scenario four does include that. And I just wanted to add that. So I, again, move that we use scenario four for our presentation to the public at our public hearing next Tuesday.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
One more question.
Okay. Mr. Owens.
Scott, the aspect of... how many people do we have employed by the county that are exempt or not paid out or who will not receive these increases?
There's 960-970 full-time employees. We have a number of part-time employees. Florida.
They're not the ones I'm getting to.
I think the majority of that, of all of your full-time equivalent employees, will be eligible to receive the 1.2 or 2.4 based upon their performance evaluation.
Don't we have a group at the top that we, the board,
shares
our salary every year?
Three appointed officials, myself, the county attorney.
Who?
The county manager, county attorney, and
sheriff
and register of deeds.
They're exempt from this?
Correct. They're exempt from the merit pay of 1.2 or 2.4%.
How about the 3.8 or whatever it is you've got?
Under the 3.8 scenario, they would be eligible.
Well, remember that 3.8 is inclusive of two components. One is a 1.4 COLA, one is the...
I think he's talking about this 3.8.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
All right, okay. What was it? I've got a problem with anybody we pay over $100,000 getting an increase automatically. I just say it up front, and that's why.
Yeah. Well, maybe we need to do something about that later at another time. Okay, any other discussion or questions? Yes, Mr. Webb, I had you. Thank you.
Two quick things. One, it works on the calculator, just not verbally.
It doesn't work logically.
It does work.
I totally agree with you.
Amazingly on the calculator. The 31% totally really threw me, but
me too,
when you get into the points and the big numbers, it's
yes, sir.
Different than my checkbook. So, yes, it does make sense. But the second thing, I agree with what Mr. Colson said earlier. I think we can leverage the money we have and do the things we want to do for scenario number two. But that's not the motion on the floor. I'm just telling you.
Okay.
I think that was a better option. It goes a longer way for our employees. And I am all for pay for performance once we have the salaries up to the range where they would have been had we not had the downturn, to get back whole and then go to a pay for performance. I thought, I think we should bring those salaries up and then do the pay for performance once we're on par with what they should be paying. And that's all, Madam Chair.
Okay. Along with that statement, I think it's important before we vote on this that there is a salary increase. Sometimes mm-hmm. when it's not the top thing that's offered out there, it sounds as if there's not a salary increase. And it does include the 2.6%, which everybody can get up to a 3.8%. So I think that's real important that this scenario that we're going to vote on is that all of our employees are going to get an increase in that range. So
can I make a clarification too? On scenario number four, as well as scenario number one, it shows the 2.6 and 3.8%, which would be for all employees. But if you go back to day one, my original presentation to the board talking about the reclassification of sworn law enforcement deputies with a 1.2% increase.
So that's an addition.
So that actually, they could get between a 3.8 and 5%.
Thank you for reminding me of that, because you, or everybody of that. Would you kind of repeat that, that the sheriff's deputies could get?
The original presentation discussed the work the sheriff and I had done and had worked on, and I came forward recommending the reclassification of the beginning deputy pay from a grade 65 to 66. With that, we were then going to do a 1% across the board increase to all sworn law enforcement officers, whether in detention or deputies. And also the certification program piece was in there that we were going to also, is recommended to allow the, I think, positions of the lieutenant and above to also to be able to participate where they cannot today. So, and I'd give you a table showing probably, I think, six different scenarios that they could earn based upon the certification piece gives them opportunity for 4.8 per certification. There's two certifications they can earn. But certifications aside, they could earn between 3.8 and 5%, not including certifications.
So that is still in the budget along with this 2.6, 3.8 for the deputies and the sworn officers.
Correct.
And if they add certification, it could be higher than that.
Right. That was the six cases. That was case one and two. And then the cases three, four, five, and six went, ranged from 8.6, 9.8, 13.4, and 14.6% potential salary increases.
If they do all four of the things that we've spoken of.
Yeah.
That's very important. I'm glad you remembered to share that. Yes, sir. And then we're going to vote after you.
I want to ask Florida this. The 2.6 or the 3.8%, again, what percentage of our employees will be getting the 3.8% overall based upon?
The majority would get the 3.8. That's going to be about 60%.
60%.
60%.
The other 40% who are already past that midpoint would get the 2.6.
And can we point out a lot of, not a lot, but a good portion of those, that 40% who's only getting the 2.6% might be because they are newer employees?
No, they're further. They're further along in the.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I'm sorry. I'm adding.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Does that answer your question, sir?
Yeah,
okay. All right. Does everyone understand the motion? We're voting on scenario four, the budget scenario four, as it is on this paper. Okay. All those in favor of that scenario, will you please raise your hand? It passes.
Do you want to have a show of hands the other way in case anybody does not?
If you want to, all opposed, you may raise your hand if you'd like.
Okay.
Okay. Do we need to set a time now before we dismiss for our public hearing?
We have already have that set and advertised.
I mean, I know it's on the list and it was set. Would you state it?
Sure. It'll be 1 week from today. It'll be Tuesday, June the 7th at 7 p.m. here in the commissioner's, well, the Eugene James Auditorium.
Okay. June the 7th. Just want the public to know.
7 p.m.
And we'll be meeting on the 6th prior to that. But
correct.
The public hearing for the budget, I just kind of wanted the public to hear that. I know we've already advertised. Okay. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I had someone in my office the other day discussing salaries and benefits, and I couldn't answer it. Scott, I'd like for you and Dwayne to pick out two or three different categories of whoever the people are, but they ran through to me And they talked about, Dwayne, you know, I asked you one time, the 10 or 8 holidays that we have.
Yes, sir.
You came up with $2.1 million it was costing the taxpayers.
Yes, sir.
They went through a list, talked about that. They talked about the retirement plan, the 401K. They talked about how many of the holidays, that not holidays, but vacation is granted. They talked about the aspect of any and all fringe benefits. And they totaled up to me there that day about $12,000. And, of course, I couldn't dispute it. I didn't know. But that basically the public and the taxpayer is not aware or don't see that they're funding our good employees. And, you know, we have all this argument about the employees not being paid adequately. But there's a lot of funds coming from taxes that contribute to the benefit and welfare of our employees. And if we could have an example, one told me he's coming to the public hearing and asked that question. Yes. That's the reason I'm saying it.
That's a good idea, even like two or three scenarios that would work. Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
Madam Chair, number 7 hasn't been discussed yet.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, I apologize. Thank you very much, Mr. Colson. The animal shelter guys, y'all need to give me a...
Sure.
Quick heads up when I start heading you in the wrong direction.
As we reported to the board, I believe on Monday, May the 20th, it was a workshop from Friday.
Yes.
The last day of your workshop before this one. We did appear before Greenville City Council on Monday, May the 23rd, at their request to discuss the and to present where the county is regarding the animal shelter expansion and addition. You had voted prior to that regarding option 2. But I think the motion was conditioned upon unless there was other input from municipalities that would direct the board otherwise. So we then went before the Greenville City Council, gave a presentation before them. The police chief, Mark Holtzman, also was there, provided some comments, had a rather lengthy conversation with the city. The outcome from that was they did vote. I think they had 4 of their 7 council members there, but the 4 did vote to ask the county to consider doing a study between the city and the county. I think it's meant for all municipalities, not just exclusively the city of Greenville, to study consolidation. Then the question then came up as to how quickly the county felt it needed to move along with option 2. And I basically said, you know, they said, do we have 2 weeks to get this done or do we have longer? And I said, well, we're not planning on turning dirt tomorrow. And I said, eventually, yes, we will need to add on to the shelter, but I said I would venture to guess after some discussion, I said I would think I could recommend back to the Board of Commissioners if there was a 6-month window in here, if you were so amenable to a joint study of consolidation that we could delay this project. But I said I did tell them at some point, if no resolution is made, we do need to begin pouring concrete and installing rebar and that type of thing to expand the shelter. So I told them I'd come back to you. I did get a formal letter from the Greenville City Manager, Barbara Lipscomb, who's kind of memorialized her board's action that night. And so I'm looking for your direction as to if this is something you'd like to do. We did discuss that we felt that it would be fair for the two jurisdictions to jointly pay for such a study. I don't feel that we have the expertise on staff to take in all the nuances as to, there's a lot of caveats in terms of I think it was pointed out, the City of Greenville Animal Protective Services made 6,000 calls last year. Well, we made 2,000. They make a lot of calls for things that we don't make calls for. So in terms of what we do, what they do, what they would expect, I mean, is there going to be the same type of services delivered in each jurisdiction and all those kinds of things? I would highly recommend that somebody, a neutral third party, help us walk through that if the board's wanting to go the direction of a consolidation study.
What are you talking about in cost for a study?
I don't know. We would, if you're interested in this, we would be happy to. I can't imagine. I mean, I'm just going to guesstimate 40, 50.
I was going to say 50.
Yeah, 50,000.
You know, some studies can be expensive.
Right.
And some can be reasonable.
I did tell the city council, I said that I know this is not a real popular term or topic, but a study. They got kind of a chuckle out of that because they I've done so many studies lately.
Madam Chair?
Yes, sir.
Tom's been right in on this probably more than anybody else. How do you respond to that letter that Scott was alluding to, Tom?
Well, when I read it, I was somewhat hopeful. I looked at the calendar of our budget and theirs, and the timing really is kind of bad. I think, well, everybody here knows that I'm for consolidation. If trying to get the city of Greenville, which is Albatross in the room, to get them to understand that consolidation really has a lot of pluses that go along with it, I'd say I'd support the six-month delay.
Okay. Mr. Garris.
How much money have we already spent on studying this subject?
Not that much. We asked that question was asked a couple of days ago. What did we say, 19,000?
Between 15,000 and 19,000.
Okay. Well, that's much more than I had anticipated. Yeah.
The original contract was maybe
It's $134,000.
So all
he spent.
All we've done is the programmatic design part of it. Programming portion of it. We have not designed any portion of the shelter yet.
Okay, so if we prolong this to make this study, would we also include the other municipalities?
Absolutely.
Yes. As a matter of fact, we sent a letter out late last week informing them, updating them, kind of saying this conversation was occurring.
Okay, well, I would surely think we would include them, but my next question was, did they want to be included?
Well, until we came back to you, I didn't want to ask them until you tell us you want to do a consolidation study.
Okay. If you remember, they gave us a non-committal, there was only, I forget which ones gave us the non-committal, because I think they were looking to Greenville to see what Greenville would do.
So, but if this is going to be a joint study funded by the county and Greenville, should those other municipalities be involved in that to show their level of commitment also?
If they would like to utilize the shelter under
a
consolidation model, I'd say yes.
I think that, I agree with you, Tom. I think the consolidation is the ideal way to go, but I'm not sure that the county will be able to perform the services at the level that Greenville is used to their satisfaction, because if we perform services at one level for a municipality, then wouldn't we have to do that same level of service for the whole county? I'm okay with the delay for the study.
I'd like to see the breakdown of those so-called 6,000 visits and how many of them are really things that a responsible pet owner ought to be taking care of themselves. My dog dies. Do I call them up and tell them to come get my dog? Or do I take care of the dog myself? If I undertook the responsibility to have the dog in the first place, mm-hmm. you would think that I could bury it or whatever I want, you know?
I agree with that.
So I really believe that if that was really broken down, and I'm not even sure we'll be able to get it broken down, because quite frankly is when the county has asked for information from the City Animal Services or whatever, PA, whatever they are, is they have been less than responsive. Is that a fair statement? They don't come back and if we ask them for some data, they don't always give us the data right away.
It's difficult.
They're difficult. And I don't know why, but they have been. And so if we really saw that breakdown, if it was truly available, you know, somebody on the city council might be saying, we're doing what? I found it very interesting that when this was all going on, then when I got a hold of Rick Smiley and Calvin Henderson and so on, they hadn't had a clue of, I blindsided them, basically. They didn't know what I was talking about. And I would have thought that at least something would have gotten through Barbara to them, and they would have understand that there was some talk about it, but now if the doors are opening and they're starting to look at it seriously, Then I'll make a motion that we do what Scott says and that we postpone it for 6 months in the hopes that we can come up with some kind of a, I'm going to say a joint study to come back with the recommendation for us. Where do we go from here?
I'll second that.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
I have one statement.
And I do too. Sir.
My concern is if the citizens of Greenville have been used to a certain level of services with the city of Greenville handling their animal control, and then we take it over, or we combine, not take it over, we consolidate. Right. And the level of service is less than what they were used to getting from Greenville, then we're going to be criticized. That's a concern I have.
I think you're right, there will be some criticism, Jimmy, but at the same time, is right now people, whether they live in the city of Greenville or town or in the county, they don't know where to call half the time.
One, I've had three meetings with three separate people who do some things in the city, and I am totally listening to what you say because you're exactly right. The thing that I want us to do as far as the county is concerned is we are in the driver's seat. This is our animal shelter, and this is our program. And to have any one of the municipalities to say, we want you to bring us in, but we want everyone, we want it to be like we have done it, regardless of whether it's one of the smaller ones or the large ones, we have to have an idea as far as that, you know what I'm saying? In other words, what is it that we want to do as a county relative to doing services for all of the people, whether they're in the municipalities or the counties? What can we afford to do? What is right to do? I don't even think there is a law that says we have to even do animal control. But we're doing it, and I'm not advocating not to, but I am saying that it is our animal shelter. These commissioners and commissioners before us have voted for us to support it, to build it, and to do the job that we have done. And I think when the towns and the municipalities need to know before they answer questions what it is we are willing to offer to them. And it will not be what these people I've spoken to in the city. It won't even be close to what they're used to.
Well, Madam Chair.
I'm totally in favor of the, and I'm going to vote for but I want us, it's our shelter.
We have talked about having a collaborative meeting. And this is a topic I think will be good for that, because you have all of the municipality members in the room and all of us in the room, and the feeling can come from that group. I know you may not agree with it, but this is one thing that is countywide and an emphasis on the citizens.
Madam Chair, if I may,
yes,
also.
Sir.
The length of stay of animals with the city in some cases is abnormally long. And animals' behavior start to change after a few weeks. And to keep them for extended times can be harmful to the animal. In fact, it can even be dangerous to people. The city does not spay and neuter. And so when they release an animal through whatever mechanism, it's not mandated like it is in the county. So therefore, they potentially are adding back to the problem.
Exactly.
Another thing is that even though it's administered, and I could go on for an hour if you really want to hear it. But even though it's administered by the city of Greenville Police Department, state law mandates, doesn't suggest, mandates that you're supposed to have shots, rabies shots, for any undocumented animal within 14 days. They have them for much longer and they don't administer rabies shots. In fact, they don't have the people to do it. Well, I'm going to stop there. So all I'm going to say is that I'm trying to just say, when you hear about the superior services that they're performing, if you want to listen to the hour presentation, I can debunk much of it.
Take Mary out and tell her about it.
You don't want to hear it?
Okay, we got the motion. Thank you. Let's vote on whether we're going to do the study or relative to it.
Motion.
Yes.
It's unanimous.
Okay.
But I still like to see it on the agenda for the collaborative.
Motion to adjourn, Madam Chairman.
Thank you. We have a motion to adjourn. Is there a second?
Yes.
All in favor?
Yes.
We are adjourned.